out here at 4717 Liberty.
Life on Liberty.
Life Vision is giving light to all the people in this area. But we're going out, we're reaching out, because we're loving God, and we want you in here with us, because the love of God is present.
And I'm so honored that you chose to take a listen to this message. I want you to just sit back, relax, enjoy, let God speak to you. I hope He reveals to you some things as you hear this message. Enjoy.
David against them, saying, "Go count the people of Israel and Judah." So the king said to Joab and the commanders of the army who were with him, "Go through all the tribes of Israel from Dan to Beersheba and take a census of the people so that I may know how many they are." But Joab said to the king, "May the Lord your God increase the number of the people a hundredfold while the eyes of my lord the king can still see it. But why does my lord the king want to do this?" But the king's words prevailed against Joab and the commanders of the army. So Joab and the commanders of the army went out from the presence of the king to take a census of the people of Israel. They crossed the Jordan and began from Arar and from the city that is in the middle of the valley towards Gad and on to Jazer. Then they came to Gilead and to Kadesh in the land of the Hittites, and they came to Dan. And from Dan they went round to Sidon and came to the fortress of Tyre and all the cities of the Hivites and Canaanites. And they went out to the Negev of Judah at Beersheba. So when they had gone through all the land, they came back to Jerusalem at the end of 9 months and 20 days. Joab reported to the king the number of those who had been recorded in Israel. There were 800,000 soldiers able to draw the sword, and those of Judah were 500,000. Let's stop right there. So I'm going to take my thought from verse 2, where it says that he wanted to know how many people were there. And I want to talk about counting on people versus counting on God. Counting on people versus counting on God. Father God, we come to you right now, God, asking you to open up your word. Speak as only you can speak, God. Have your way in this place, God. We feel your presence already. And so we ask that as we go forward in this service, God, that you'll give your people the answers that they need to the situations that they're facing. God, we pray strength in this place. We pray healing in this place. We pray right now that your Holy Ghost power would meet every one of us at our point of need. God, you know the needs. You know from the right to the left, from the front to the back, what your people are standing in need of. And so right now, we declare that it is already done. We declare victory in this house in the name of Jesus, God, that your word would hit where it needs to hit, God. That your word would touch us and transform us and change us, God. That your word would liberate us, that your word would free us, that your word would take us to new heights in you, God. We thank you and praise you, God. We believe you are able to do anything but fail. And so we stand here, God, confident, God, that you're able to do just what we need you to do in our midst. We thank you and praise you in advance. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We receive it in the presence of the Lord.
Right here in the text, it starts off and we see that the Israelites are going to battle. They're going to fight. They're going to war. And in the Bible, our text tells us that David's attention immediately shifted from fighting. His attention immediately shifted from leading. His attention immediately shifted from doing what he normally did to now counting. David decided to count and sign up all the fighting men of Israel to see how many soldiers that he could depend on in battle. David wanted to see how many men he could rely on and how many were going to be with him. How many he had in his entourage, how many he had in his crew. Right here we see that David was basically tripping off of how powerful and wonderful and great his support system had become. He was probably thinking, now I don't have to fight with rocks and slingshots.
Yes.
Now I don't have to fight with that ragtag motley crew. Those degenerates that came to me in the cave, I don't have to deal with that. Now these are military, these are people with military expertise that I'm fighting with. I'm not in a doodlum anymore. I don't have to hide anymore. Now I'm at a place where I have resources, and now David was counting his resources. Not only was he counting his resources, he was counting on his resources.
Yes, amen.
He was the king now, and apparently he was tickled with everything that he had going for him. You know, sometimes we can get to a place where God will bless us and do things for us, and we get tickled with ourselves.
Yeah.
Or y'all quiet. We can get carried away and tickled with how good we are doing, and we start counting how good we got and how great things have become for us. And David got to this place so much so that he became caught up in his army and how many he had with him. I want to ask you this morning, what are you caught up with on this morning? When David got caught up with how much he had going for him, immediately we see a problem. Up until now, we really didn't see David having any issues. Most of the time, he was just fighting, trying to make it. And isn't it interesting that as long as we stay in battle fighting, that we really don't have much time to do much other? But once we get to a place where God brings us to where he promised us, then there's room for us to start feeling ourselves. Getting carried away with how great we are. And so now David has a problem, because now a man who has always been dependent on God up to this point, now when God gets him to the place he said he would take him, he stops depending on God, and now he starts putting his confidence in people. I'm preaching hard in this place. Now he starts putting his confidence in what is around him. He starts relying on his own power. He starts relying on his own strength. And so the Bible says he calls for a census. And this ordinarily wouldn't have been a problem. This wouldn't have been ordinarily a problem. Anybody in leadership understands that you gotta count stuff. You gotta see what you're dealing with. You gotta take inventory. Amen. Normally wouldn't have been a problem, taking inventory. Except the fact that God told him not to do it.
Oh.
And so even in this day and time that we live in, there are certain people in here today that God has told you not to do things that other people are doing. And it seems okay for them to do it. But if God told you not to do it, then you better not do it. God told him not to do it. David was not supposed to number Israel because, and the main reason why David wasn't supposed to number Israel is because Israel didn't belong to David.
Oh, preaching real hard on this
one. Israel belonged to God. And anytime we start thinking we own stuff and we own people, my family. Now think about that. Think about when we call people our people. They don't belong to you. And most of the time when they are your people and you call them your people and you lead them like they belong to you, they're a mess. I know I'm telling the truth. Your family. Because you need to rethink how you are even defining these relationships that you have. They are not yours. They belong to God. My money.
Yes, yes.
Your money is jacked up.
Yes, amen.
Because you think it's yours. See, David ran into a problem when he started acting like God's stuff belonged to him. There's got to be a godly fear, a godly reverence over everything that God has given you stewardship over. The job is not your job. That's why when you want to act a fool, if you understand that it belongs to God, you better not act a fool. Is this helping anybody?
Yes, amen.
For many of us, we start tripping like David. And we need to understand that none of it belongs to us. It all belongs to him. My car. Can't drive nobody in it. You can't bless nobody. Can't give nobody a ride because it's yours. But you the same one that was sitting in the dealership praying that the to God. It's amazing how we can flip the script on God.
Yes.
One minute, God, I need you. The next minute, this is mine now. Yeah. God told David not to count the people. Ask somebody next to you, what did God tell you not to do? He said, don't count the people. Or in other words, he said, don't count on the people.
Wow.
Count on me.
Come
on, count on God. If I can title this message today, it will be Count on God. That's a real title right there, Count on God. I believe that's the same message God is saying to us when it comes to everything that we're facing. Everything that's in front of us, the situations we find ourselves dealing with. And I don't care how sophisticated or together you look when you come to church, every single one of us is dealing with something. Every single one of us is up against some kind of battle. Everybody in here is fighting some demon, some issue. Situations we find ourselves up against, even how we order and plan our affairs. We need to understand that God is speaking to us this morning. Don't count on people. Don't count on people. Don't count on people. Or more specifically, don't count the people. Don't count the resources. Don't count on what they're going to give you. Don't count on what they're going to do for you. Don't count on people to love you. Don't count on people to show up for you. Don't count on people to support you. Count on God. Psalm 118 and 8, you can jot this down, all the note takers. It says, it's better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in people. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put your confidence in people. And so when it comes to David, God knew that if David counted his men, his army, his troops, that David was in essence really only counting his own ability. He was counting his ability, his capability, his power, his strength, his authority. And that's why he was in such a vulnerable place anyway, because anytime you start depending on you, it's like me with cooking. Like, I used to cook every single day. Chris is 26 years old, so I pretty much cooked until he went to college. After that, I kind of just cooked when I felt like it. Made some sandwiches. You know, got creative with stuff. But when I stopped cooking consistently, then it was like sometimes I cooked something and it turned out really good. And sometimes I cooked it and it was not that good. So I was like, how it tastes, y'all? Because I had changed up. I had changed up. And anytime you change up on your technique, anytime you change up on your war plan, on your strategy, then you find yourself slipping. You find yourself not being as on point as you were in different areas. So when it comes to David, he was counting on himself. He was looking at the strength of his soldiers who he thought had it going on. That's why they were part of his team. And just like God wanted David to depend on him and not people, I believe that's the word that God would have me to speak to this house this morning, because there's some of you in here and you're counting on your resources. You're counting on your check. You're counting on people to come through for you. And most of the heartbreak and most of the disappointment that you have is because you counted on people and they let you down. But God is saying, he's reminding you this morning, depend on me. Come on, trust in me. Come on, lean on me. Rely on me. Come on, not your family, not your friends, not your job, not the people in your life, not in your strength, not in your gifts, not in your talent, not in your good looks, not in your charisma, not in your connections, not in your abilities. Trust me. God wanted him to see the same thing he wants you to see today, that I'm all you need. Come on, God wanted him to see, hallelujah, that he didn't need a big old army to fight the battles for him. Come on, as long as God was with him. Come on, if God is for you, who can be against you? Come on, he wanted him. He said, I want you to see that I've been there for you. I've been a consistent God in your life. And he proved that to David back when David was keeping his daddy's little sheep. Come on, God proved that to him when the lion came. God proved that to him when the bear showed up. God proved that to him when his back was up against the wall fighting the Philistine giant who was standing over top of him. Come on, he proved it to him when he was chasing, when he was running from Saul who was chasing him. He proved it to him, hallelujah, when he was living in caves and when he was going left and right trying to get away from enemies. God proved to him that he didn't need anybody but God. And isn't that what God has been trying to prove to you? That I'm all you need. That I'm with you. Come on, you might not have the same testimony as David, but he's brought you through some stuff. Come on, he's brought you through some stuff. You had some spears thrown at you and God brought you through. Come on, it wasn't your strength, but it was the strength of God that brought you through. The enemies that wanted to see you go down, the weapons were formed, but thank God they did not prosper. And that's why you're standing here today. And somebody ought to give God praise if you know it wasn't in your strength. Not by might, it's not by power, but by his spirit, saith the Lord. That's why we're still standing. always going to be with you. Always going to be with you. Come on, he's not like man. He doesn't switch up on you. He doesn't change up on you. He's not moody. Hallelujah. He's not temperamental. Come on, he doesn't have strings attached. He just loves you just the way you are. And when he's with you, he's with you. Nothing you can do about it. Proved it to him, and he's proving it to us over and over again that I got you. Come on, he's proving that I got you. Come on, I got you, Elder Danielle. I got you, Deacon Cynthia. He's proving that I got you. I got you, Abijah. I got you. I got you. I got you in the palm of my hand, and nothing can pluck you out. Come on, because I got you. Come on, I know they said they got you, but I got you. And the way I keep you is unlike anybody else can keep you. The way I cover you is unlike anybody else you know. I cover you even when you're asleep. Hallelujah. I stay awake all night because I'm protecting you. I'm watching over you. I know there are threats coming against you. And before they can even hit you, I'm at war against you. I send angels ahead of you. I send angels to charge over you. Brought you this far. Do you think I'm gonna leave you now? He said, I brought you this far. I brought you this far. Other people would have been in a psychiatrist's office. Come on, popping pills and sitting there. Come on, wearing two less shoes on the.
Come on. Hallelujah.
But I kept you. I kept you. Come on, oh, to be. That simply means I provide for you. Come on, I provide for you. When the check comes, you might be thanking your boss, but I'm the one that made that way. Your boss don't even like you. Come on, your boss don't even like you, but you keep getting promotions. Come on, your boss. Because there's somebody else who's in control. There's somebody greater who's working on your behalf. Come on, there's somebody else that's pushing the button to wake you up every day. Come on, goodness and mercy are following you all the days of your life. So he said, just trust me. Just trust me. Just trust me. I'm sure when David was making this decision, I'm sure deep in the Holy Spirit was speaking to him saying, just trust him. Trust me, trust me, trust me with your problems. Remember, it's me. Come on, this morning, God is reminding you, he's speaking to you. Remember, it's me. It's me. I'm the same God. I'm with you. I never left you. Trust me. Trust me in your darkest hour. Trust me when your back's against the wall. Trust me when you feel all by yourself. Trust me when you feel afraid to do it. Come on, trust me. Come on, touch somebody near you. Say, trust him. Trust him. Trust him. Trust him. With tears running down your face, trust him. No money in your bank account, trust him. Come on, feeling all by yourself, trust him. Come on, nobody to turn to, not sure how everything's going to work out. Just trust him. Come on, he said, I'm Alpha and Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. He said, I'm the author and the finisher of your faith. In other words, he said, I wrote the book on you. I know how every chapter goes, and I know how the end goes. And because you're with me, victory is guaranteed. Children all the time, I say failure is not an option. Sent my son off Friday. It was just me and him.
And I asked him, I said, are you scared? And he said, yeah. And I said, failure is not an option. God has brought you this far. And God will keep on bringing you to the place that he promised you. Come on, great is ahead of you. Come on, touch somebody and prophesy, great is ahead of you. Greater is ahead of you. It's ahead of you. That's why you got to keep walking. That's why you got to keep pushing. Come on, that's why you got to keep moving. That's why you got to keep coming. That's why you got to keep trying. That's why you got to keep believing. Come on, look at somebody and say, keep believing. Keep believing. When it gets rough, keep believing. Come on, when you don't understand how you're going to make it, keep believing. You can count on God. You might not be able to count on people, but people might have let you down, but you can count on God. God was proving his love to David all his life. He's been proving his love to you all your life. It's like my husband, he, you know, like the husband-wife relationship, that's the relationship of Christ with us. Amen. So he doesn't have to come home every day, even though he does. He doesn't have to come home every day and say, I love you. No, he does that. But the fact that he goes and works and takes care of me,
yes,
says that he's proving his love to me.
Amen.
You know, I take my ring off every night because I can't sleep with anything, earrings, nothing on. I'm just like, my mother said, I'm the princess and the pea. He keeps his ring on all the time.
Amen.
You don't take it off. God is like that. He don't take it off. Everywhere he goes, he shows people that he's attached and connected to you. That you belong to him. That you're spoken for. Come on, even in your singleness. Come on. Even with nobody that's claiming you right now, somebody's claiming you. Come on, somebody's claiming you. He says, I got you and I'm married to you. Come on, I'm everything to you.
Amen.
He's proven his love all his life, and now he gets here. And David acts as if God hasn't been faithful to him. He gets here, and now he puts his faith in people instead of God. In other words, he disobeys God. Counting the people was just an act of disobedience. God told him not to do it, and he did it. Anytime we disobey God, then we show him that we don't trust in him.
Amen.
I told you not to do. Your parents ever tell you not to do something? And you say, why? And if you had a mother like mine, you'd say, because I told you so. I'm not going into no explanation about why you can't go over their house. I'm not going into any explanation about why you can't date him.
Amen.
I'm not going into any explanation about why you can't have what it is that you just asked me for. It's because I said so. And so David had one of those moments, even though he should have known why God had told him not to do it, he did it anyway. And by counting the army, he's showing that faith is in his own military power and not in the Lord's power. And so any area that you have in your life that you have come to a level of expertise and you start leaning on your own expertise instead of God, then you are in clear disobedience of God. When we put our confidence in anything or anybody other than the Lord, we always end up disappointed, drained, depressed, despondent, dejected, and defeated. Our strength has got to be in the Lord and not in what we have.
not in our power, not in our bank account, not in our money, not in our friends, not in our boo, not in our stuff. And when it is, it's always disobedience. Psalms 27 says, some trust in chariots, some trust in horses. That was the way they got around back then. So some trust in certain vehicles. Whatever your vehicle is. I'm not talking about the car you drive. I'm talking about how you get from point A to point B. How you manipulate and maneuver from one. Some trust in chariots, some trust in horses, but we will remember the name of our Lord. So the Bible says Joab, David's military commander, reminded David that God is in control. Amen. Came right in. He had enough guts to speak up to the king. Mm-hmm. And to tell him, listen, God is the one that's in control, David. You've got to be connected to people who are not yes men. You've got to be connected to people who are willing to stand up and speak up and tell you, like Joab told David, that God is in control of this. Amen. Come on, anybody here glad you got some people in your life that hold you accountable? Yes. That when they start seeing you disobeying God, that they'll say something to you? Yes. People in your life that'll tell you, you know what, you ain't serving God like you used to serve God. Yes. I see a pullback in you. Come on, I don't see that same determination. I don't see that same passion for God. Where you been? I ain't seen you in Bible study. Anybody got any people like that in your life? Yeah. Joab checked him. He said, listen, God is in control. Don't act like that after all God's done for you. Don't you dare try to act like you got here by yourself, David. Joab spoke up even if it meant getting in trouble with the king. He asked David, why would you take a census? Why would you count the people? Hasn't God done enough for you? Hasn't God been good to you? He basically told him, if God wanted to do this, if God wanted to add more people to your army, couldn't God make your army 100 times bigger for you? But no additional help is required when the Lord is on your side. Come on, when God is your help, you don't need nobody else's help. In other words, if everybody walked away from the battle, you would still come out victorious because God is with you. In your life, you need to understand that if God wanted to add people to it, he would. If God wanted to add people to it, he would. If God wanted to add more zeros to your paycheck, he would. Y'all didn't like that one. He would do it. If God wanted to do whatever he wanted to do in your life, he would do it. Because he's God. And what he's in essence saying when he doesn't add things and people to your life, that can't you see that I'm enough? Can't you see that I'm enough? Sometimes he's saying I can't add it to your life because you can't handle it. Come on, read the parable of the sower. Every single one of them got what they could handle. Some of us are in the place that we are right now because that's all we can handle. That's all our character can handle. Come on, that's all our big mouth can handle. Come on, that's all our integrity can handle. That's all our wants and our desires can handle. I'm preaching harder than y'all saying amen. Come on, sometimes we need to understand it's not the devil, but it's actually our own weaknesses and our own character deficiencies that keep us in a certain place. There's a millionaire in every single one of us. But until we learn how to handle being a thousandaire, you forget it. Come on, look at somebody and say, it's that simple.
the people that win the lottery, they end up broke a year later. The boy, what the guy said yesterday at the thing, he said, fast money don't make money. Anything that comes to you without work, anything that comes to you without labor, anything that comes to you without sacrifice, it's going to just slip through your hands quickly. David still didn't listen to Joab. Sometimes you have people in your life who try to talk sense into you and you still won't listen. My mother called them hard-headed. We used to say that to us. You're just hard-headed. You know the saying, hard head makes a soft behind. He wouldn't listen. He wouldn't listen to Joab. Sometimes God will speak through other people to us, and we won't receive it because we don't think that they qualify. Joab was under David. And because he didn't have all that David had, David said, "Boy, get out of my face. I'm your king. Go do what I told you to do." And being the king, he overruled them. So Joab and the military leaders went on out, counted the army of Israel like David told them to. They went, and it took them 9 months and 20 days to complete. We're in the ninth month. Joab came back and reported they had 800,000 soldiers in Israel and 500,000 soldiers in Judah. So, sounds like David had a lot of people with him, right? A lot of people, right? I'm sure having a lot of people with David, and here's my preaching point, I'm going to get out y'all way. Probably made David feel like he was really big, powerful. Because counting what you have can make you think you're doing well. Wow. Counting what you have. Anybody ever had a nice amount of money before you just keep counting it? Straightening up the money. Just keep counting it. You know, you put some money away, put it in your little hiding space, and then you go back and count it again. Makes you feel successful. Makes you feel like you got it going on. Am I the only person when you got a good balance, you just keep going back and checking it? Make sure it's all right. Because you are counting what you have, and counting what you have makes you feel, you know, when you got a little bit of money in your bank account, you walk with a different swag. You hand them that card with a lot more confidence than you normally would. When my husband and I first started going together, he might as well have like 25 credit cards. Yeah, a whole lot of credit cards. You know, in college, you know how they just give you a whole bunch of credit cards. He had them all. We go out to eat. He say, when the check come, try this one. I look up at him like, what? What do you mean try this one? It might not work, but I have other ones. I'm talking about. Sometimes you don't have a full confidence in what you got. When we were little, we go to the store and we put stuff on the thing, and my mother be like, "Put that back." We be like, "Why?" I said so. My mother be like, "How much is it now?" Checking,
right,
to make sure she has enough. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But when you get to a place where you think you got it. Anything on you paying for other people. David felt like he arrived. And here in this ninth month of the year, there's some of us that we think that we have arrived. But I want to challenge you over the next 20 days to stop counting your stuff. Stop counting on your support system. Stop counting on the stuff you've been counting on, and start counting on God like you did when you first came to Him. Come on, start trusting God like you trusted Him before. Come on, take your relationship with him to a whole nother level. 9 months is when a baby comes forth, and God wants to birth some things in each and every one of you. Come on, you are right at the place of delivery, but you've got to rethink, and you've got to refocus, and you've got to dedicate your life to counting on God and not on yourself. Not on your own strength. Sometimes we look and say, look how far we've come. But God doesn't want us to take our eyes off of him and get caught up in us. God doesn't want us to get caught up in our accomplishments. Am I talking to anybody in here? Because none of us will be where we are without Jesus. Do I have a witness? Come on, none of us will be where we are today without Jesus. So like David, he doesn't want us to depend on us and who we think we are and where we think we have arrived to. He wants us to look at him. And what is that? That's what we call faith. Somebody say faith. Faith is the confidence that we put in something. And God wants us to put our faith and our confidence in him. I'm out of time. But misplaced confidence is what messes people up. This is what messed David up. This was the beginning of a mess. This was the beginning of a spiraling life for David. All before we talk about David, the hero, David this, David winning, David this, David that. And now when David misplaces his confidence, and starts looking at how he has become so wonderful. Disobeying God, that's when he starts slipping. Look at somebody and you say, I don't want you to slip. Come on, keep your confidence in God. Come on, count on God, not on people. Count on God, not on people. Every time you count on people, you end up crying. You end up hurt. Come on, you end up busted and disgusted. You end up burnt. You end up financially drained every time you take your confidence off of God and put it on people. I don't care if they have your last name. Family will disappoint you. Come on, family will use you. Come on, family will drain you. Family will crash up your stuff. And then ask you what you're going to do about it. And so God tells us not to do certain things to keep us from heartbreak. You don't want to listen, then go ahead and be hard-headed. But the things that God tells you to do are for your good. Look at somebody say, it's for your good. And if you want to be hard-headed, and you want to be stubborn, and you want to be a knucklehead, then keep on disobeying God, and then we run down here at the altar for you. And there's tissue right here, too. But you've been warned. Come on, God warns you. God gives you a word of warning. As Bishop Gina would say, stop it! Stop it! It's disrespectful to God to put your confidence in anybody else anyway. He's your healer. Yeah, you go to the doctor, but you gotta eat right. Oh, y'all got quiet on me right there. The doctor gonna give me some pills. The doctor ain't even gotta give you no pills. You take care of your body. Come on. I tell the young people nowadays, look, watch out, take care of your liver. Drinking all them shots. Come on. I'm telling the truth. Partying. Come on. Partying and drinking and doing all this damage to your temple. And then we, God heal me. Really? After you trashed the temple I gave you? Drugs and all kinds of stuff that just destroyed, overeating. that will keep you longer. Come on, when you got purpose, you don't look. The devil ain't even got to kill us because we're killing ourselves. Eating hog maws and chitlins and fat back. And wonder why our cholesterol is so high. We can't even walk up a flight of steps to sight. Come on now, the saints have got to do better. Somebody said, we got to do better. The temple. Look at somebody say, your body is the temple of the Lord, your God. So treat it like that. Come on, y'all stay. Y'all don't like this word no more. David found out that even though after he realized that he was wrong, you know, some people always say they're sorry, but never doing nothing different. Jesus, I preach right there. Oh, I'm so sorry, but you never do anything different. David, here's what made David a man after God's heart. David would mess up royally. Somebody say, that's me. Mess up royally. But here's the difference between David and a lot of us. David meant it when he said he was sorry. Come on, look at somebody say, that's the difference between David and you. David meant it. And you know. David was really sorry. So when you're really sorry, there are corresponding actions and behavior that go along with it. I'm teaching too good.